Our Father in heaven, we're so very thankful that we have you as our Father, the Creator, the sustainer of everything in your providential care. You run and operate your universe. You are taking it to your intended goal, and you've revealed that to us in your holy word. Lord, we're studying the starting points, and we know, Father, if we any of us who have read the end of the book, we know the ending point, that all glory is brought to Jesus. And Lord, your redemption extends to develop a whole new heaven, new earth, where we will dwell with you forever. And Lord, help us as we explore these starting points to get a grasp of what you're doing in time, between eternity past and eternity future, where we dwell. We might just get our heads around what you're doing. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, starting points. We're in Genesis. Let's do a real quick review. Genesis 1:1, I believe, is the statement of the very creation of everything, the whole universe, because he uses two extended expressions. In Greek, it's hendaiosis, it's a merism in Hebrew. Heavens and earth, because there's no word for universe that means universe in Hebrew. God created everything that was. In verse 2, he focused just on the land, because the land was unsuitable for man to dwell on. So beginning verse 3 all the way down to 2:3, he's talking about how God how he made the land suitable for man, and he kept repeating, saying, it is good for what? For mankind. It's good for us, okay? And so we're the focal point. I believe this. I believe that man is the focal point of the whole creation. We'll see. We're the only one who's in the image of God, okay? And we're the focal point. Made a little lower than the angels, but in our glorified state, we're going to be above the angels. We're going to judge the angels, okay? He's going to elevate us, and that's part of the goal. 2:4 was the first toledot. These are the generations of. This is the account of. It comes from tolad or yalad, and it means to beget, the first begetting passage. And he's saying this is what the earth begetted. Then he talks how he made man out of the dust of the ground. And so we get the second creation of man, how the earth brought forth man. We're dust, and to dust we return. We're all part of the earth. In chapter 3 is recorded the fall of man into sin, and all mankind sinned in Adam, so that we're all sinners, according to Romans 5:12. When Adam sinned, I sinned. You say, how could that be? Well, I'm human. He was human. So when he, the human, sinned, every human was in him, okay? And so we all sinned. That's our original sin. You know, I got a grandbaby going to be born any time. You know, I got a text from my son yesterday, my grandbaby. They said, if not born by Sunday, they're inducing, okay? So, and that baby's going to look so cute and so innocent, right?
Yes.
Yep. The Bible says it's a sinner. Why? Because back when Adam sinned, little Liam sinned, okay? Because he's part of the human race. He needs redemption. That's why we want to teach the children. We want to evangelize. We want to share the gospel because they need Jesus, okay? Whole race fell into sin. The first family is a family of antithesis. I don't know how, they're just opposites all the way down. It winds up being two different cultures. One is the world's culture, and the other is a culture of worship. And so we have the Cainite, worldly culture, and then you have the Sethite, godly culture. Last time we picked up with the written account of Adam down to Noah, and then we after that genealogy where he gives everybody in it died except for Enoch, who walked with God. God took him. We get to the next chapter. We get to the Nephilim. We spent quite a bit of time on the Nephilim. And it comes from the word Nephal in Hebrew, which means to fall. I take the historic view of both the Jews and the early church, that these were spirit beings that came down in their fall from heaven, and they're demonic beings. They somehow married with the women. Obviously, I think they took bodies with that like demons do. And they produced an offspring that seems to be genetically manipulated somehow. I don't know how that happened, but something happened there. Because they produce offspring that are giants. Not just giants physically, which they are. They're mighty warriors, which they are. And they're terrible, terrible sinner, so much so that God wants to destroy the entire earth. He's going to have a great flood come and destroy everything that breathes on the earth. And then we found that little expression, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Or Noah found favor, is the new translation. Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. And for his sake, and then there's three terms that are used for him. He was righteous, he was blameless, and that he walked with God. Righteous is the right standing before God. Blameless was used for the sacrificial victim. It could not have any blemish. And I'm thinking in that passage, what it's really saying is, he was not corrupted genetically like the rest. He wasn't corrupted, having been corrupted by these fallen angels cohabiting with women and all that going on. And so that he was without blemish in that sense. And then also that he walked with God like Enoch. He had this really close relationship with God. So God tells him to build the ark. And we started covering that about the great flood last time. And he builds the ark. God brings all the animals to him, pushes them in the ark, seals up the ark, closes the door. And that's kind of where we left off. That was a quick review, don't you think? I just want to bring up speed. All right. Now we're doing the starting point of the new world. Okay? We are living in the new world. But God remembered Noah, didn't forget about him. All the wild animals, all the livestock that were with him in the ark. And he sent a wind over the earth, and the waters receded. Kind of a professor said, you know what kind of wind this was? This was the jet stream. And he was convinced that God just brought that jet stream down because he's going to dry off an earth that's been sat for some time now, and it's taking time to receive that. I got the air sock out there on the ark. I don't know that Noah actually had one, but it's really blowing too because God sends this wind, and the wind is going to cause the waters to recede. So the flooding ceases. Now the springs of the deep that were broken up, water, remember, was blasting out from the from subterranean, and then the floodgates of heaven, that canopy of water that was over the earth is just crashing down these through the floodgates. And he said, God closed those up after the 40 days. It stops, and the rain stopped falling from the sky. This is so interesting to me. I'm going to jump ahead of myself a little bit, but note the word sky. Rain fell from the sky. Where did rain fall from, really?
Clouds.
He doesn't mention clouds. Why? There's that body of water up there. The floodgates are open. The rain comes through the floodgates, not from the clouds. Very interesting. Just little subtle things are in the text. We're not scrutinizing every single word like the scholars do, but we're picking up just little pieces, certain things that just jump out at me as I go through the text. The water receded. That's what the next text says. The water receded steadily from the earth, and at the end of the 150 days, the water had gone down. You can start doing some calculating here. I meant to include the calculation for this. There's different ways they calculate this, but here we got 150 days. You had the 40 days where it rained. You had the 7 days before that he went in waiting for God then to bring the rain. And you can start counting this all up to figure out exactly how long it took for the beginning of the going into the ark to the time he came out of the ark, because the text is pretty specific. The ark settles after the water is receding, the wind's blowing, and it's going off. And it says, on the 17th day of the 7th month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. Anybody know where Ararat is at? Mm-hmm. Anybody know country it's in today?
Turkey?
Yeah. And you know how many people wanted to go there and explore Mount Ararat? Mm-hmm. What's the problem? The government won't let them. Okay, yeah. It's kind of like they won't let them do excavations, you know, on the Holy Temple Mount underneath it, because they're afraid they might just find Ark of the Covenant there, because there's one of the theories that that's where it was hidden, and that when it was being invaded, they took it down through the tunnels and hid it. Well, if they come up with it, that legitimizes the Jewish claim to the Temple Mount, so they don't allow any excavation going on there. So there's all those things going on. But the Ark settles on top of Mount Ararat, and it says, and the waters continued to recede until the 10th month, the first day of the 10th month, on the top of the mountains, became visible. By the way, I took these pictures at the Creation Museum.
Yeah, isn't that cool?
Yeah. Anybody been to the Creation Museum? All right. Yeah, well, I think we should go there as a church field trip next spring. And we'll take in the ark. I've been to the ark too, the new ark that's there. Yeah, that's very cool. So now it's after 40 days, Noah opened the window he had made in the ark. Now some think it's just an 18-inch square window up at the top. Some think it's an 18-inch window that goes all the way around to ventilate. And that's the way those photos that you showed you had it that way. And that's the way the one down in Kentucky, the reproduction, is done it. Anyways, he opens up the window and he sent out a raven flying back and forth until the waters had dried up from the earth. He doesn't tell us why he sent the raven, but he does tell us why he sent the dove. It's assumed he sent the dove and the raven for the same purpose. It said, then he sent out the dove to see if the waters had receded from the surface of the ground. But the dove could not find a place to set its feet because there was water over all the surface of the earth, and it returned to Noah in the ark. The raven does not. The raven's a hardier bird, and he can, I think, soar, okay? And so he is able to fly, and he goes out, and then he soars, and I think he comes back to the ark. He doesn't come in the ark, but he doesn't come back. So I think Noah said, well, that's not getting me the information I need, okay? So he says, let's try a dove. So he sends out a dove, and the dove couldn't find a place to rest, so the dove comes back into the ark, and he reached out, took the dove, and brought it back to himself in the ark, okay? So he waited another 7 days, and again he sent out a dove from the ark. And when the dove returned to him, in the evening there was in its beak a fresh plucked olive leaf. Then Noah knew that the water had receded from the earth. He said, I know. It's drying out. I mean, that was a big flood. He knows it's drying out, so. But then he sent out a third time, he sends out, this time a dove, he sends him out. It was a raven and the two doves. He waited 7 more days and he sent the dove out again, but this time it did not return. So he knew he could land, and so the waters are receding. He hasn't opened up the door or anything yet. But on the first day of the first month, in the 600th year, Noah's a old guy. Mm-hmm. 600th year. On the first day, the waters had dried up from the earth. Noah then removed the covering from the ark and saw that the surface of the ground was dry. By the 27th day of the second month, the earth was completely dry. Then God said to Noah, come out of the ark, your wives, your sons, every kind of creature that's with you, I'm jumping down, so they can multiply. Here's support. So they can multiply in the earth, be fruitful, increase in number upon it. Have you heard that expression before? Mm-hmm. You ever hear that expression before? Genesis chapter 1. Mm-hmm. Be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. Mm-hmm. It was said to man, but here it's also saying it now to animals. Okay, we'll take these off, going to multiply, fill the earth. Okay. So they leave the ark. And so Noah came out together with his sons and his wife and his sons' wives. And all the animals and the creatures that moved along the ground, all the birds, everything that moved on the earth, came out of the ark, one kind after another. So everyone came according to kind. And so how long were they actually in the ark? Well, if you take all the references, you calculate them all down. You can't read it, so I'll enlarge it. This calculation has, they were there 364 days. Some of them have more, some of them have a little less. Depending on how you calculate some of the ones that are, just tell you what day of the month, okay? And what kind of calendar you're using, all right? If you're using a 365-day calendar, a 360-day calendar, how are you calculating your time? So it's pretty much, he's there a year. The guy is in an ark for a year. I would have gone bonkers, I think. Cabin fever. I mean, he didn't have the internet, he didn't have TV. But you know what he did have?
Animals.
You know what he did have? Come on, think. What did he have?
Animals.
A lot of animals to take care of.
Family.
Okay. But for leisure time, I'm sure he had a workshop in there. You know, because
yeah, they portrayed if they did.
What did he have?
Family.
He had family. Something really important. I thought this was so cool because at the Ark experience, they actually showed it. He had a library.
Oh, that's right.
A library.
Yeah. So you could read.
He's got the Book of Adam. He's got all these books that he's been talking. This is the account of. He's got documents there. I think he's got the Book of Enoch on the ark.
No, it's a dumb idea.
Otherwise, how did it survive? Okay? He's got these books. So he can read. Gets a little, he said, man, I can't sleep tonight. Well, he starts reading some genealogies. He's off, right? You know how that is. All right. So, and this is a, he's there for a year on the ark, okay? Now, the starting point of new worship. As soon as he gets off the ark, Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of the clean animals, remember, there were more clean animals than there were of the other animals, okay, the common animals, clean birds, and he sacrificed burnt offerings on it. Now, the reader of this are the Jews, okay, who are about to go into the promised land. They know from Mosaic legislation, okay, what a burnt offering is. I know what a burnt offering is because I read Leviticus chapter 1, verses 1 through 6, very clear what it is. There's six parts to what you do to kill this thing, okay? And then he arranges it and he burns it. They know exactly what, when he says that, they know exactly what he did. He's worshiping God. They know that the, in Hebrew it's called the Olah offering, the Olah. We get the word Holocaust from it. Holocaust offering. You know what that means? Total destruction. This offering is totally offered to God. I don't take any part of it for myself. It's all God's. It means total consecration to God. And so what he's saying here, it's the first thing he does, man, he's offering, saying, God, I am totally dedicating myself to you. There's nobody, everybody else is gone. It's just him and his family. I'm totally committed to you. That's where worship starts. Worship starts when I give myself to God. That's worship is about, we call singing worship, right? And then when it's come down to today, oh, wasn't that great worship service? Oh yeah, I love those songs. You know, that kind of thing. But worship, I want to suggest, always involves a sacrifice. They did here, and I think I can show throughout scriptures that first time the word worship is used, it's actually in Genesis 22, where Abraham was told by God to go offer his son, actually it says his only begotten son, go after your one and only son, offer your son Isaac on the altar. And he says to the servant that was staying with the stuff that they brought, you stay here while I and the lad go over and worship. What's the worship? I'm going to sacrifice my son. I'm going to sacrifice my son. That's powerful stuff. You see, worship always involves a sacrifice. In the New Testament, there are like five different sacrifices that we as believer priests, because I'm a believer priest, that I bring. And one of them we do every Sunday is I give my offering. Another one is I give my praise of my lips. Another one is I do is I help my neighbor. I help people in the name of Jesus. Another one is I reach in my pocketbook and I take out my offering and I put it in the offering plate. That's a priestly service. And the big one is Romans 12:1-2. I give him my body as a living sacrifice. But that's what worship is about. Sacrifice. He sacrifices. While he's sacrificing, the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma and said, and he makes a promise here, never again will I curse the ground. Did he ever curse the ground before?
Adam sinned,
the ground was cursed. Second time, ground is cursed. It's totally destroyed. Everything on it, it's not, okay? He said, but God says, I'm no longer going to hold the ground responsible for having produced you. You're going to be accountable for yourself. All right? I'm not going to hold the ground accountable because of man. Even though every inclination of his heart is evil from his childhood. What's that telling me? I participated in Adam's sin. You didn't have to teach me to do wrong as a child. You just don't. It's my nature. And so he's saying, listen, God says, I know it's your nature, and never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. It's not going to happen like that again. As long as there is the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. I find something very interesting here. Cold and heat. This is the first references to temperatures. He's talked about seasons before, but he hasn't talked about temperatures associated with the seasons. I believe it's because at one point there was a big canopy of water over the earth and it worked like a greenhouse and it moderated the temperatures everywhere. That's why we find fern fossils at the polar caps, because at one time they weren't frozen over. We find things that are like tropical there in the fossil remains because it doesn't start cold and hot, doesn't start until after the flood. It's also parallel to the summer and the winter, the cold and the hot. It's just done in a chiastic arrangement, and he lays out in a parallelism here. It's a little bit poetic in Hebrew. We don't see it in English, but it's there. In any case, that was the world that then was. There's a world that then was and the world that is now. I want to jump to the New Testament. 2 Peter chapter 3, it says this. First of all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, where is this coming he has promised? You're saying, Jesus said he's going to go into heaven, he's going to come back. And they're going to say, where is his return? Come on. Everything goes on every day as it's always gone. Listen, ever since our fathers died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. Most evolutionists don't believe that the creation part. They'll say everything's the same as it has been since the Big Bang. Okay, that's what they'll say. All right. This is the key to modern science. All their theories is based upon everything goes as it has since the beginning. It's called uniformitarianism. Everything goes as it did now. People ask me, do you believe that God created those 6 days, when he was day one, day two, day three of book of Genesis 1? Are those 24-hour days? And I'll say, I don't know. I know they were solar days. That is, evening and morning made one day. So however long it took the earth to go around, but I don't know, maybe it took 30 hours back then. I don't know. I wasn't there. I do know it took one revolution was one day. Another revolution was the next day. Maybe it took 50 hours. Maybe it only took 10. I don't know. I know it was a solar day. See, I don't buy into the uniformitarianism here that everything goes as it always has. For a second reason. I think the flood changed everything. Flood changed everything. We'll see that as we move through the book here. They lived almost 1,000 years, most of the people, before the flood. They're restricted to 120 after the flood. Ooh. So, things don't always go as they have, all right? And that's a really important, that's a downfall. They say, oh, everything's going just as it always has. He says, but they deliberately forget. I love that. They do this, they suppress the truth, Romans chapter 1 says. They hold down the truth in unrighteousness. They refuse to accept what they know is truth, according to Romans chapter 1. They deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens existed and the earth was formed out of water and by water. They deliberately forget the way it really was. And he's talking about the flood here. I don't know, have anybody seen this? Expelled by Ben Stein. You gotta rent it. Ben Stein is not a Christian. He's Jewish, he's on TV a lot. He's been on. If you ever watch Fox News, he's on every now and then with Bill O'Reilly, and he's on. He's on the business channels because he's more a business guy. But
he's on commercials with Shaq too.
Oh, is he? Yeah. Yes. Anyway, I didn't even know who he was. Okay, but. In the movie, it's a documentary type movie. The movie's called Expelled, and what he's saying is academia in America has expelled any thought that is not uniformitarianism, evolutionary theory. And then he brings in all these Christians, well, not even Christians, you can't say Christians, some of them are Jewish. Some of them are secular design. They believe in, what I call that? Intelligent design. Yeah, intelligent design that This could not have happened by chance. And what he says is, academia in America deliberately suppresses facts and truth about creation, or in his case, intelligent design, that there had to be an intelligent designer for all of this, and they're suppressing the truth, and they're not allowing people who are giving intelligent arguments against them to even voice their position. It's very excellent. In the middle, there's a little sequence where he shows the impossibility that Darwin, he's convinced Darwin would not be an evolutionist today. Because Darwin started out, his whole presupposition was everything started from, life started from one simple cell. And he destroys the whole concept that there is even such thing as a simple cell. On the sub-biological level, they make the point that a simple cell, one simple cell, on the sub-biological level, microbiological level, is as complex as our entire universe. So for Darwin's theory to stand, you've got to have like a universe already in existence in order to have a simple cell. And it all shows design everywhere. And so there had to be a designer. And so, excellent thing, but they deliberately forget, they suppress the truth. And that's part of what the Creation Museum, the Ark experience, they all are saying, listen, we've got scientific things to back up what we're saying and our theories and our belief, and it's very, very impressive. Okay, that the earth was formed out of water, the earth on the third day, they said, let the earth appear. It comes up out of the water. In geological terms, I call that the Azoic Age. There's a formation of the earth that's called the Azoic. There's no life forms. It comes up out of the earth, the water's rushing off, there's sedimentary deposits, and there's no life forms in it. Works perfect for me. Anyway, I want to go to the New Living Translation. Because the way they translate this is really cool. They deliberately forget that God made the heavens by the word of his command, let there be, let there be. And he brought the earth out from the water, comes up, surrounded by the water. Okay, there was a time when there was actually a canopy over the earth, full of water, like an ocean above the ocean, the sky in between. Now watch, as we go a little bit further. By these waters also, the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. Those waters above came crashing down in the day of Noah. And the whole land was covered. Even the highest mountain was covered. And the whole thing was destroyed. Peter is affirming exactly what's in Genesis chapter 6 through 9. Now, it's here where I get the world that then was. In the King James Version, it says, by these waters also the world that then was deluged and destroyed. Similar to that, okay? But the world that then was. We are not living in the same world that Adam and Noah lived in both worlds. He had a foot in both worlds, okay? But I mean, I'm living on the other side of the deluge. By the same word, the present heavens, God, by God's mighty word, the present heavens are reserved. He is providentially taking the earth to its intended goal. He will never, ever destroy the world by water again and wipe out everybody, but they're reserved for fire. Okay, let's break some fire. Yeah. Being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. As in the day of Noah, those who did not know the Lord perished. There's a judgment day coming when those who do not know the Lord will perish. That's why we preach the gospel. That's why we solicit all men everywhere to repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ so that they can flee the judgment that is to come. All right? That world, the old world's gone. We're in the present world, but looking towards a future world. Okay? And this passage and other passages talk about the destruction of this heaven and this earth, and then there's a new heaven and a new earth that will be developed. Now, he goes on, he says, but do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day. So the Lord said, somewhere around 33 AD, that I'm coming back. Like, oh, I'm coming back. So maybe on this principle, how long has it been since Jesus has been God?
About 2,000.
2,000 years, but a day with the Lord is as a...
2 days.
2 days. It's only been like 2 days. We are in such a big hurry. We are like, I gotta have everything instantly, gotta have it now. God is not limited to time. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some men understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. This way I believe. When the last person of the church age accepts Jesus as Savior, wouldn't that be great? Some Sunday morning, we preach the gospel here, and some person raises their hand, prays the sinner's prayer, and accepts Jesus, and God says, that's the last one in the church. Come on up! And we're all blown out of here, man. We're raptured, and we find ourselves in heaven. Would that be awesome?
Yeah.
All right, now listen. And that's what he says. He's patient. The reason he hasn't come back yet, he's patient, because the last guy hasn't come in yet. Last gal, last child. We don't know who that is. As soon as they do, then his end time clock starts ticking. All right, so I got some questions here. How might the scientific doctrine of uniformitarianism cloud scientists' judgment? That's a pretty easy one, come on. Everything is always the same. How might that cloud their judgment?
Well, they're making an assumption, and they believe the assumption is absolute, so.
Limits the possibilities.
Pardon?
It limits the possibilities.
Else. Listen to possibilities.
It removes supernatural.
It removes the supernatural. How good, how far back is carbon-14 dating good? Even the scientists will tell you this.
20,000 something.
Yeah, I think it's like 10,000. It's not. It starts losing its accuracy. Well, why? Well, let's face it. The flood took place. Just a little bit. I think that if I go according to the Jewish timing, it's like near 6,000 BC is when the creation took place. So of course it breaks down because it doesn't work that way. Uniformitarianism, things just destroy them. The gravitational pull of the Earth, okay, on the moon, it actually pulls the moon in a little bit all the time because our gravity just barely pulls it in. If you go millions of years, it should be sitting right on top of the Earth, according to uniformitarianism. All right. There's problems everywhere. Uniformitarian clouds their judgment, so they make other explanations for what it is. All right. Here's what I found. This I thought this was pretty good. Darwin's evolution argues that life arose from primordial sea out of a lifeless planet through a chance collision of chemicals that over billions of years, this biological accident gave the rise to all life, including humans. In other words, nothing plus time and chance equals everything. I mean, that's hard to digest.
Everything. That requires a lot of faith, unlike our faith, but
yeah,
that's based on a lot of faith as well.
Yeah, and one pointed out to me, chance is really a non-entity. It's nothing. So watch it. Nothing plus time and nothing equals everything. You see what I'm saying? I don't know. If you challenge the presuppositions, you'll find that science has very, very, so-called science, has very, very little explanation for anything. I don't really disagree with much of the facts. I mean, I believe in all the geological structures just like they do. I mean, the Azoic, the Mesozoic, all the layers. I just disagree with them on the interpretation of all those facts. They just don't interpret them correctly through the God-given revelation of the Word of God. How might the flood explain some of the Earth's current geological formations? Well, all right, I think this is not a geology class.
I think you touched on it. You have sea life shells on mountaintops at 14,000 foot.
Yes.
I mean, either the mountain was down there at sea level or below.
Or the fish were up there.
Or the level of the ocean came up.
Yeah.
And it's all over.
It's all over.
It's all over.
Now, does that mean there's some mountains that don't have that? Well, of course there's some mountains that don't have that. Some of them
or volcanic upthrust after the flood. Of course they wouldn't have any of that on it. Because they weren't covered by the flood because they didn't exist back then. Okay? So, and there's a lot of other things. There's another event we'll talk about a little bit later called continental drift, how the continents divided and drifted. That caused a lot of buckling. If you drive down through the Appalachian, I mean, that's pretty close. And you'll, as you're driving along, you ever see the all the layers of the strata of the earth, mm-hmm. and how they're tipped up, and they're that's because when the continents shifted, they buckled and upthrusted, and then what you have is, you know, our ice age where it carves them out, and you can, they're exposed, you can see them so easily. But flood geology explains a whole lot more of what's going on in a reasonable way than I think the scientific, so-called science does. Can you think of any other catastrophes that may have contributed to the geology of the Earth? I just mentioned that. Okay. I answered my own question. Continental shift, volcanic eruptions, the new mountains, all that kind of thing. Okay. So, sorry about that. I didn't mean to answer my own question. Let's move on. Starting point of a renewed mandate. Genesis 9:1, and God blessed Noah. What did God do after he created mankind? He blessed them. He blessed them. He blesses them. We're going to see here that there's a lot parallel between chapter 9, chapter 1 and 2, okay? God blessed Noah and his son, saying, be fruitful, increase in number, and fill the earth. I'm jumping down to verse 7. As for you, be fruitful, increase in number, multiply on the earth, and increase upon it. It comes right from Genesis 1:28. God blessed Adam and Eve, blessed them, and said, be fruitful, increase in number, and fill the earth. What this is the renewed mandate. This is a reboot. This is, hey, mankind, this is your do-over. Hey, this is your mulligan. Mm-hmm. For you golfers out there. All right? Hey. You get a new start, fresh start. And that's what's going on here in Genesis chapter 9, beginning of verse 1. Now, we're adding some new things. The fear and dread of you will fall upon all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air and upon every creature that moves along the ground and upon all the fish of the sea and that are given into your hand. Prior to this, there was no fear. There was no fear going either way. You go up to a lion. We went to the zoo. Last weekend with the grandkids, and these wild animals, they're all in cages and they're all some distance. They're just afraid of us, though. Did you ever notice that? The peacock was out. All of a sudden, the peacock's out there. So I said, walk real slowly. You pet it. They walk real slowly. Sure enough, they get a little bit. It's gone. Why? There's a fear of us. That's what's going on here. It wasn't like that before. All right? There's a new fear. And you can trace this back to Genesis 2. There's fear there. Oh, Adam was afraid and he hid. See what I'm saying? There's a parallel that's going on here. It's a new world. Everything that lives and moves will be food for you, just as I gave the green plants. I now give you everything, but you must not eat the meat that has its lifeblood still in it. Now, that's not saying you can't eat a rare steak. It's saying while it is still living, life's blood means it is still alive. You can't just eat live. You kill it first. Okay? You kill it first. I prefer my food cooked. I'm not a sushi person. I don't even like my fish uncooked. I like it all cooked. But what he's saying here is before this, man was a vegetarian. At this point, God introduces the fact that, okay, you can now eat meat. But you do not eat it while it's still alive. Okay? Then we have the beginning of human government. And we have the accounting of life. As for you, your lifeblood, you're alive. Your lifeblood, the fact that you're a living being. He's just saying that you got to kill the animal before you eat it. But your lifeblood, I will surely demand an accounting. I will demand an accounting from every animal and from every man, from each man. Two, I will demand an accounting for his life, the life of his fellow man. Now, I want you to notice here, I will demand an accounting. And I get down to this last one. I will demand an accounting for the lifeblood. In the Hebrew, it's not of his fellow man, but of his brother. Now, does that take you back in the book of Genesis? Chapter 4, Cain and Abel. The question he said, am I my brother's keeper? What is the answer?
Yes.
Yes, you are. You are going to give an account for the life of your brother. Other people. I'm going to give an account for my treatment of the life of other people. So he's established here. The lifeblood, life is important. Okay. And then we come to the basis of, we have the first reference of capital punishment. It's instituted here. God says, whoever sheds the blood of man, remember, he said, Abel's blood is crying out from the ground to me.
Yeah.
Okay? Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. He's saying, now I'm giving to you the responsibility to govern yourselves, and I'm giving you the highest thing that a government can do is to take the life of a capital offender. And so he's saying here, he's institution of capital punishment. I believe in capital punishment. You say, why? Well, the Bible teaches it right here. But why? Why, if somebody takes a life, why would you take their life? He gives us the answer. For in the image of God has God made man. What he is saying here is, listen, that person is an image bearer of God. And when you attack and destroy and kill, you are destroying and killing the very image of God. And you're accountable for that. That life is so sacred that you've just taken, that you forfeit your own for taking that life. And so what we have here is God is saying, listen, I'm putting you in charge so that I don't have to come down and destroy everyone. You are to govern yourselves. And this is the beginning. Some of those who are dispensational, such as I am, this is the beginning of the dispensation called human government, where we are responsible to govern for the glory of God. We're responsible to govern for the glory of God. And that means when there is a capital offender, that person is to, found guilty, is to be, their life is to be rendered life for life. In the Ten Commandments, the chapter that follows, in chapter 20, 21, it says, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, life for life, okay, of justice. Now, there's two aspects of the image of God. I want to talk about this for a moment. There's two aspects. Theologians call the one aspect the wider sense. I don't know if this is in your notes. I think I put this in later, so you might have to write this down. In Genesis 5:1, when Adam, he'd already fallen, but Adam, it goes out of its way to say that Adam begat his son in the image of God too. Here in 9:6, it's the reason for capital punishment, the image of God. That person is bearing the image of God. In James 3:9, which we'll come across this Sunday, it says, how can you even curse someone who's made in the image of God? Watch what you say about another person. He says, that's because we still have it. We still have the image of God in some wider sense. But at the same time, in a narrower sense, we've lost it. I know that from Ephesians 4:24 and Colossians 3:10. When I get saved, it says, I am renewed in the image of God. I'm renewed in the image of God, which means I lost it, but now I've regained it. There he says, you are renewed in righteousness, holiness, and true knowledge. So here's the deal. I think that the wider sense of the image of God is that I am a person. I am a person. I have intellect, emotion, and will. I have self-sensibility. I'm aware of myself, self-awareness. And I have self-determination. I decide what I'm going to do. Those are things that a person does. Animals don't do that. They don't have intellect, emotion, and will, self-determination, self-awareness. They have what we would call instinct. But we have this aspect of personality. I still have that. I'm still a person. God is person. I am person. I can have personal relationship with God. But there's something hindering me. I lost it in the narrower sense. Adam was made in the image of God in the narrow sense. He was perfectly righteous. He walked with God in the cool of the day, or the wind of the day. Holiness. He was set apart from everything that was contrary to God and was fully devoted to all that God was and is. True knowledge, he understood everything correctly. You and I don't. Even what we do know is skewed by our fallen condition. We've lost true knowledge. I am restored to righteousness when I accept Jesus Christ. His righteousness is imputed to me. His holiness is imputed to me. And I, as I know Jesus, know him who is life eternal. I know the truth, okay? Because I know him who is the truth. So I've restored what I've lost, I've regained. So I can be, as a Christian who's walking in the Spirit, I can be fully manifesting the image of God. The person doesn't know Jesus, they only got it in a wider sense. But even when that wider sense is there, God says, I have no right to take that life. No right. I want to stop here at this, because this is a very important passage. At what point do you think a person becomes an image bearer of God? At conception, birth, adolescence? Whatever. What point does a person become an image bearer of God?
I think just when you get to the age where you have consent, maturity, where you can accept that you are or aren't.
So,
say like an adolescent.
That's when you become an image bearer of God.
I think it's when you accept the Lord.
When you accept the Lord? Someone else? What point do you become an image?
I think when you're created. Yeah. I think to conception.
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 Conception, right?
At least in a wider sense. In the narrower sense, I become full image bearer of God when I accept the Lord, okay? But I'm not even to curse somebody because they're made in the image of God, so. Now, if it takes place at conception, see, this is a very important part for me. I think I got it next. Should your view of image bearing influence your understanding on social issues like capital punishment and abortion? Obviously, this passage says yes. I wouldn't capitally punish somebody except if they've destroyed the image of God in someone else, then they are to be capitally punished. But I bring up abortion because it's really important to me. Our culture, oh my goodness, there'd be over 100 million more people in America if we didn't abort. Isn't that amazing? It's just amazing. If it's true, which I believe it is, at the moment of conception, that becomes a human being. In fact, if you were to extract this DNA, you would find out that, oh, yep, that's human. If you were to ask, is that alive? Well, of course it's living, okay? So it's alive, it's a human being. And I go back to Genesis 9:6, whoever sheds man's blood, whoa, that's man. Mankind. Okay? Whoever sheds man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. What he's saying there is, hey, I sure wouldn't want to be the doctor performing an abortion. There's no way. Okay? Because what you have just done is effaced the image of God, one image bearer of God from planet Earth. And God says, you deserve the electric chair. They had an electric chair back then. But by man shall your blood be shed. And so this should influence our understanding of that. No.
Question for you.
Yeah.
Do you believe in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit? And if so, where does that line up between conception, birth, adolescence, or other?
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because I do believe in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And at the moment you believe in Christ, you receive the Holy Spirit. But we have a passage in Luke that talks about John the Baptist, who was full of the Holy Spirit from within his mother's womb. Now, to be full of the Holy Spirit means that that is a person. That's just not a blob. That's not a non-entity. That is a person. The Holy Spirit fills people. Okay? At what point, I only know that one case where he fills in the womb. That's all it's got to take for me to tell me that that's a person within the womb. God, the Holy Spirit, could indwell at any time. Now, I know that Jeremiah the prophet was called before he was born. It tells me that first chapter. And he's treated as a person before he's ever born. Psalm 139. It says, God, you know all my parts before I was ever born. You knit me together within my mother's womb. And he's talking about himself as a person, not as a non-entity. And so all those things make me come to the conclusion that a person becomes an image bearer of God the moment that conception takes place. Now, I have two biological sons, an adopted son, and I have lost three babies, okay, and two boys and a girl. So out of my slew, I only got one girl, and she died before she was ever born. I had a son that was born in the third trimester, and it was a premature birth. He wasn't any longer than my hand. And he struggled and gasped for every breath that he had. He would have lived by today's scientific methods. He would have been alive, okay? But then they didn't have what we have today for him to develop his lungs. And so he had inadequate lungs, and he died. My little son was an image bearer of God. And they call it an abortion. It was a natural abortion. But God is the giver and taker of life, not man. Okay? God chose to take my son. We named him Mark. God chose to take my son Mark. Not me, not the doctor, not my wife. God does, because God is the one who gives life, who takes life. And that's what this passage is saying. We're made in the image of God. We do everything we can to keep people alive. Everything we can to keep people alive. All right? I'll move on, unless you got more questions. Yeah?
I got a question here. We say, whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. Like this. And so how about now, for example, recently there's a self-defense like this.
Pardon?
If somebody has a gun, and then that man self-defense to kill him, so
A matter of self-defense?
Self-defense.
The Bible teaches, I think the Bible teaches self-defense. There is a time when you have the right to defend yourself. There's also an ethic in war, okay, that is part of the government's responsibility is to protect its people, okay? And that's part of what this is all about. You protect your people. This is a premeditated murder that the text is talking about, as opposed to self-defense or defending like your nation, because you'll go on to find in the Bible that there is Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verse 1 says there's a time and a purpose for everything under heaven, a time for war, a time for peace. There's a time to engage in self-defense, and that is the government utilizing its responsibility, not an individual taking on his own fight. Now, in a self-defense matter, you have every right to defend yourself. Yes.
Oh, sorry. Excuse me. My myth is that, okay, for example, that, Tom killed Jerry because Jerry take a gun, want to rob him. And then, so the law say Tom is not guilty because he's self-defense. However, in Bible, we were told that if the people want to walk 1 kilometer, you gotta walk 2 kilometer for him like this.
I'm not sure I caught all that.
So is it okay? He killed Tom killed Jerry, because of self-defense in Bible.
Okay, from self-defense.
Yes, Bible okay. is okay.
Yeah, he would be okay. Self-defense is a whole different matter. This is a premeditated murder. Yeah.
Oh, it's okay.
In self-defense, yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, but I think I was told that in Bible, okay, which chapter I don't remember that, said that if we don't revenge by ourselves, God will revenge. And what? If somebody wants to walk 1 kilometer, we could walk 2 kilometers with him.
Oh, walk a mile or 2 miles?
I yeah, 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 oh, that one. Yeah,
like, kilometer.
And if somebody wants to take you, take your clothes, we give all his jewelry.
well, yeah, yeah, that is true.
Like this, so
that,
I don't understand.
You know, that we respond with grace and forgiveness,
mm-hmm.
okay? But we can defend ourselves, and oftentimes we have to defend ourselves. Okay, you know, if somebody broke into my house and was threatening my wife with a gun, and a gun is at hand for me to use, I wouldn't hesitate for a moment. Okay, I would not. Okay, or if someone were thinking about raping one of my grandchildren. I don't know. I don't think I would hesitate for a moment to defend my granddaughter. Okay. The Bible here is this is premeditated. This is not self-defense, and in self-defense, you have every right. If you do self-defend yourself later, it will say, in the book of Joshua, they set up cities of refuge. You defend yourself. By killing somebody accidentally, or you defend yourself, you can run to a city of refuge and find refuge there so that a kinsman doesn't come after you and kill you. As long as you're in a city of refuge, you have refuge and safety. And so there is a mechanism there for your own preservation, that just because somebody is even accidentally killed, they don't have the right to come and kill you, that kind of thing. So does that make sense?
I'm sorry, I still don't understand. Is it okay? Because that's those things in different chapter in the Bible like this.
Mm-hmm.
First, I said that if somebody lets you force you to walk 1 kilometer, you're gonna walk 2 kilometer with him.
Yes.
And another one is just like that's what I said.
If you want
we don't revenge. God will revenge for us like this.
He
but
does.
If that somebody just like you said. That's a self-defense. Somebody want to kill Jerry. Want to kill Tom. So
okay.
Tom defense kill him.
There's a difference. I think in self-defense, they're attacking you. You fight back to defend and preserve your own life.
Uh-huh.
There's a sanctity of life that I preserve my own life. I protect my own life. Okay. Getting revenge on someone for having done something. If they've killed someone, I don't get revenge. I have to go through the court process, so that. The courts, the government, exacts
mm-hmm.
life for life,
mm-hmm.
not me as an individual. And that's why we would have a court system and a government. Does that make sense?
Oh, okay. Thank you.
All right. Good. Other questions? All right. Let's move on to Genesis 9:8. And then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I will now establish my covenant. And I believe this is the second mention of the word covenant. The first one was in chapter 6, verse 18, where it was predicting he was going to establish a covenant. This is the first covenant in the Bible. And I just, here it's laid out for us. The other place it's predicting it. That's important. There's a whole system of theology called covenant theology. And it tries to structure the scripture around covenants. I'm more in line with the people who believe in biblical covenants than those who are in theological covenants. The theological covenants are just kind of invented in systematic theology, and they're not biblical covenants. They talk about a covenant of grace, covenant of works, covenant of redemption. So we'll get updates ready to install. I hope they don't do that now. All right, I should have taken it off the internet. And but the biblical covenants, this is the first one in the Bible. And we're going to see a second one in Genesis 12. There's several of these covenants. When we get to Genesis 12, I'll deal with covenants a lot more thoroughly next week. Okay. And I will now establish my covenant with you.
What that means is it's a bond between God and man. He said, I've got this bond relationship with you and your descendants after you, with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, the wild animals, all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on the earth. And here it is. This is the covenant. Never again will I totally destroy by a flood. I will establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be cut off by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood that destroys the whole earth. That's the heart of this covenant that God says, I'm never going to destroy the world with water again. Now, he will with fire. We saw that. There's going to be, at the very end, he'll destroy this world with the fire, but he'll create a new heaven, a new earth. Now, and then he says, now there's a sign of the covenant. Later, there's going to be another sign of the Abrahamic covenant, circumcision. Right now, this is the sign. This is the sign of the covenant that I'm making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations. I have set my rainbow, first mention,
of clouds.
There it is. First mention of clouds. There were no clouds before this. There's a canopy of water up there. This first mention of clouds. See, did you see little subtle drop-ins saying, listen, now we got clouds, and now you can have a rainbow. You know, the refraction of the light rays through the clouds. And he said, I've made it this way, so there'll be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. All right, so every time you see a rainbow, here's the message. Whenever I bring the clouds over the earth and a rainbow appears in the cloud, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all the living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Every time you see a rainbow, there's no pot of gold at the end.
No.
God is saying, I'm not going to destroy you with water.
Oh, unconditionally.
That's beautiful.
Unconditionally. Not going to destroy you with water. Not all of them. We've had floods. But I'm not wiping you all out. No, not at all. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant. This is for good. Between God and all living creatures on the earth. So God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all life. Now we come to the historical repeat. God has given the mandate. He's told them now, I've solved the problem of accountability. You're now going to be accountable for yourselves. Take care of one another. I've set my covenant, the sign of it in the clouds, that I'm never going to destroy that way again. So this is a positive, gracious thing. And then he says, these were the three sons of Noah. From them came the people who were scattered over the earth. And so this is Moses writing to his audience because he's saying, hey, listen, out of three sons, everybody gets scattered. And he wants them to know that. And Noah was a man of the soil. Now, I call this a historical repeat because that sounds very similar to God formed man from the dust of the ground. In fact, when I check my Hebrew Bible, the word soil is literally ground. Both cases. He's saying, Noah, you are just like Adam. Adam had a mandate, you had a mandate. Hey, Adam was made of the ground. Listen, you're made of the ground. Just reminding you of that. And he went and proceeded to plant a vineyard. That reminds me how the Lord God had planted a garden. You see what's going on here? There's these parallels because this is like the recreation, although it's not a creation. It's the replenishing of the earth after the destruction. All right? And when he drank some of its wine from the vineyard, he became drunk, lay uncovered inside his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw his father's nakedness and told his two brothers outside. The man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. You see the parallels going on here? Mm-hmm. He's pulling out this thing saying, uh-oh, something's going wrong here. I think all of a sudden. And he told his two brothers outside. He doesn't do anything about it. He goes, talks about it. Right. But Shem and Japheth, they took a garment and laid it across their shoulders. Then they walked in backwards and they covered their father's nakedness. I should have highlighted that as the key word. And they turned the other way so they would not see their father's nakedness. All right. And the man and his wife were both naked and they felt no shame. You see how it's picking up the themes from Genesis before the fall?
A historical repeat's what's going on here. And when Noah woke from his wine, he found out that his youngest son had done to him. Now, we don't know what really went on here. I'll just be very honest with you. There's every kind of conjecture under the sun. I think it was just that his son, Ham, didn't do anything to cover him, but went and talked about it.
Yeah.
Okay? That's what the text says.
Made light of his condition.
Yeah. He went and, I don't know what he said, but he said, cursed be Canaan. Now, Canaan is Ham's son. And I'm puzzled by this too. And so are the theologians and commentators. Why he doesn't curse Ham. Ham was his youngest son, so it's like he cursed Ham's youngest son, Canaan. The lowest of slaves he will be to his brothers. But I do notice this. This is the first recorded words of Noah. Up to this point, talked about his building enterprises, talked about the flood, talked about all the animals coming to him. These are his first words, and the first words are a curse. And it reminds me of, so the Lord said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you. And Adam, he said, cursed is the ground. He's cursed. See the parallel? We got to repeat. Things aren't going so wonderful on the reboot. He also blessed the Lord, the God of Shem. He said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem. May Canaan be a slave to Shem, subservience. May God extend territory of Japheth, and may Japheth live in the tents of Shem, and may Canaan be his slave, subservience. To the woman, he said, your desires will be to your husband, and he will rule over you. There seems to be a subservient thing going on there, too. So we see this kind of repeat of what's going on here. After the flood, Noah lived 350 years, and altogether Noah lived 950 years, and then he died. Altogether, Adam lived 930 years, and then he died. He's saying what we got here. I think this section here is saying history, life is cyclical. There's nothing really new under the sun. What has been will be again. That's a line from Ecclesiastes, okay? It's rather cyclical. Here's some questions for you. Are the parallels between the original creation and fall and Noah's new world and fall obvious or forced? What I just did, do you think that's obvious or is that forced?
Obvious.
Obvious or just coincidental?
No, there's a lesson.
And how does our world stand today?
Bad shape.
Bad shape. We're in a cycle.
Yeah.
History repeats itself.
And we're in, I think, the downward cycle. Downswing of it. Yeah. Why do you suppose Moses included the story of Noah's drunkenness, nakedness, and curse on Canaan here in Genesis? Why do you do that?
That's puzzled me more than once.
Why? I think it puzzles everybody. You ever seen this word later in the New Testament? The Old Testament?
The land of Canaan.
The land of Canaan. Canaan. Who lives in the land of Canaan?
Canaanites.
Canaanites are descended. We're going to see the next chapter. Canaanites are descended from?
Canaan.
He's writing to those people who are about to go in the land and conquer Canaan. And he's giving them a little history about the people that you're about to go in and conquer. And saying, you know what?
They're not very nice.
They're not nice people. Yeah. I think that's what he's doing here. I mean, this is a book that was written for a people about to go and take the land. All right. I thought I had questions here. I don't have any questions. All right. But were those the questions? Those were the questions. All right. Here. Let's go on. All right. We got time here. Good. The starting point of the post-diluvian world. There was the world that then was, and then there's this the antediluvian world that is before the flood, the deluge, and then the post-diluvian world. It's interesting that before the deluge, you know, that it all starts with chapter 6, you know. But in chapter 5, there's a genealogy of 10. And then after, there's going to be a genealogy of like 10. And the one before, they have lifelong, long lifespans, and then The one in he gives the years for the what's going on in chapter 10, 11, the genealogy. There are short lifespans. And so we got the flood in between, and so we've got this tension going on. Now, it's very interesting. If you go to like the Sumerian documents, you go anywhere in the world, and you find ancient documents that talk about a flood. Okay? Gilgamesh story about the flood and the Babylonian account. They all have a genealogy before it and a genealogy after it. Is that interesting? The numbers and things might be a little bit distorted. But everywhere you go in the whole world, there's flood stories and there's genealogy before genealogy behind it. We have the revelation from God. Of course there would be other people who would have the story if it really happened. It might be messed up a little bit because everybody puts their own little spin on it for their own local deity and that kind of thing. But of course we would have this pattern followed throughout the ancient world. Now, chapter 10, verse 1 says, this is the account of Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Those are the sons of Noah, who themselves had sons after the flood. Now I'm going to jump down to verse 31, 32. Now these are the clans of Noah's sons. Okay, so they had children and become clans. According to the line of their descent, within their nations, and from these nations they spread out over all the earth after the flood. Now, so what he's giving us here, in between verse 1 and the last verse of the chapter, is the nations. He's talking about the nations. Moses is now writing to tell the nation going into the land. He said, I want to give you the history of all the nations. I've just mentioned Canaan. Let's now look at all the nations, because he's brought up the Canaan issue. And he says, I want to talk about all the nations. And so he's going to start showing how they descended. The sons of Japheth. Now this is, I'll butcher some of these names, but forgive me, okay? He says he's got Gomer, Magog, Madai, Javan, Tubal, Meshech, Tiras. The sons of Gomer are Ashkenaz, Riphath, and Togarma. The sons of Javan are Elisha, Tarshish, and Kittim, and the Radanim. And from these, the maritime people spread out into their territories by their clans with their nations, each with its own
language.
That is so important. Because the Tower of Babel doesn't take place till the next chapter. So he's wanting to link that Canaan incident. Okay, I'm going to talk about all the people in the land. Then I'll tell you, they all have their own language. Of course, you know they all have their own language, because you're the most saying to the people he's writing to. You know they all have their own languages. He said, according to their own language, but later he's going to say, now let me back up and tell you how they got their own languages in chapter 11, okay? And so he said, now we know geographically, I got that swoosh with the green, and you got that on your map in your notes. That's basically the direction that they spread into, okay? Then he says, now the sons of Ham, Cush, Mizraim. Cush and Mizraim are in Egypt area, Put, Canaan. Put's also in this region. Canaan, we know, was in where we call Israel today. The sons of Cush are Seba, Havilah, Sapta, Rama. Some of these names I don't know, okay? Saptica. The sons of Rama and Sheba and Dedan. Sheba and Dedan, we hear of them later in the scriptures. Cush was the father of Nimrod, who grew to be a mighty warrior. This is the word Gibor. We saw Gibor used back with the Nephilim. They were mighty men of renown. Gibor of the name, okay? Now, it says he was a mighty warrior on the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. That is why it said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. So he's a mighty hunter before the Lord. So this this mighty man must have a relationship with God, because that's what he is before the Lord. In contrast with the Nephilim, okay, who were mighty men making their own name, okay, they were men of the name. They were doing it for their own renown. Here he's telling us that as a warrior on the earth, mighty hunter is before the Lord. All right, we get these little tidbits, just dropped in as we go. The first centers of his kingdom were Babylon. So now, I got to get to reach the Babylonians in the Babylonian area. Erech, Akkad, and Calne, and Shinar. Shinar, the plain, is in this region here. And from there, they went to the land of Assyria. And there where they built Nineveh. These names are going to pop up later in Scripture quite a bit. In fact, past Moses, down in the time of Daniel, okay, down when I think Zedekiah is king of Jerusalem, Babylon's going to come and be destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar, Babylonian king. The Assyrians are going to conquer the Babylonians, okay? I'm not the Assyrians. The Assyrians are going to conquer the northern kingdom. It's the Persians that conquer Babylon. But these are nations of the future that are going to actually attack Israel. He's giving us this layout of all the peoples. And it's almost prophetic in what it does. And Rezin, which is between Nineveh and Kala, and that is a great city. Mizraim was the father of the Luddites and the Anamites and the Lehabites and the Nephuhites and all the ites. Okay. From whom the Philistines came. Why is this important? Well, the Philistines, they're going to be enemies in the land of Canaan, the territory, specifically the Gaza Strip. Is there conflict still there today, anybody? Yeah.
I wonder.
I mean, this stuff is all prophetic. All the nations, you know, the whole Middle East and the world are right here, and the Captorites. Canaan was the father of Sidon, his firstborn. Okay, and Canaan, there was the Canaan. The Sidonians are up in that region. The firstborn of his son was the Hittites, just a little bit north of there. These are all names you're going to pick up later in the Scriptures. He's spelling them all out for us. The Jebusites, the Amorites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, the Arkites, the Sinites, all the ites. Later, the Canaanite clans scattered, and all the borders of Canaan reached from Sidon down to Gerar. You're going to see these later in the Old Testament. As far as Gaza, then towards Sodom and Gomorrah, you're going to hear that later. Adma and Zeboim, as far as Lasha. And so he's describing all these territories. This is basically the territories that they're about to go into the land and conquer. These are their enemies. And he's telling them where in the world they came from. That's what he's doing here. He says, these are the sons of Ham by their clans and languages in their territories. And you can see, you know, I put these circles on here, kind of give you the regions and directions that these descendants went, okay? And, but he says, of clans according to their languages, that means this chapter 10, follows chapter 11 chronology, but he's wanting to identify all the people groups that they're going to go in and conquer the land. And finally, we have Shem, the sons of Shem. We've got all these names, Elam, Asher, Arphaxad, Lud, and Aram. The son of Aram was Uz, Hul, Gether, Meshach. Arphaxad was the father of Shelah. Shelah was the father of Eber. The two sons born to Eber. One was named Peleg, because in his time the earth was divided. Very interesting. There's just drop, you know, the mighty hunter before the Lord. In his time the earth was divided. Two thoughts on this. One is that the languages were divided. Because he's been saying, you know, according to their language. And the next chapter is referring to what took place at the Tower of Babel. Except is the word divided is not used in that chapter. But what does he say? Because in his time, strike the word earth, it's the word land. The land mass was divided. You see, in Genesis chapter 1, when God created, he said, let land appear, singular, not lands, plural. There was one landmass. I'm of the opinion that in this passage he's saying at that time the earth was divided. Okay? Scientists tell us. I mean, this has been in the Bible since Moses wrote it. Okay? It's been there. That the whole, all the landmasses, the land was divided. So these geographical relationships somehow coordinate with, and I'm not sure if they put this all together right, but I think it's pretty close. I know from geology that there's parts of Africa that run right into South America, but when the earth divided and split into continental drift, and we got the Atlantic Ridge down the center of the Atlantic Ocean, that from upthrust on the ocean floor, spreading the continents and pushing them apart, and you got on the over on the other side, you've got the Pacific Trench that forces the Earth's crust to go back down into the trench, and it actually shifts the continents around, and you got all these that they all moved. They say it takes billions and billions of years. I think it probably happened in that guy's generation. There was one earthquake. Could be why some people lived in caves. Mm-hmm. Could keep your house standing. You know? I don't know. But it's either one of these. You know, most of them take it, well, the earth was divided in languages. But it's there. It's tucked away. He stops. And to say something like, in his time, the earth was divided. It explains how, if the Tower of Babel happened before that, they scattered. The land moves. You've got people on every continent. You've got languages on every continent that are different. It just makes good sense to me. His brother's name was Joktan. Joktan was the father of, and they list a bunch more names. Let me go. The regions they lived stretched from Mesa towards Sephir. Some of these places I don't even know over there. In the hill country. These are the sons of Shem by their clan and their language. And then we got that word language again. Therefore, chapter 10 follows chapter 11 chronologically. Is that making sense to you?
Yes.
These are the clans of Noah's son, according to their lines of descent within their nations, from these nations spread out over the earth after the flood. And I think that all follows chapter 10, that this all happened. Let's go ahead and pray, and then I'll go make those. Father in heaven, your word is amazing. Now, you have recorded for us where every people group come from. You've recorded the background of your chosen people. You've given us the line of redemption. You gave us the first gospel early in Genesis, and that there would come a seed that would crush the serpent's head. And through that line of redemption, all the way down, as we'll see through Abraham, all the way down to Jesus being a descendant of Abraham, through David, so that he could be the one who fulfills the promise as the righteous king that would come, sacrifice his own life as a priest for his people, and be prophet, priest, and king. Lord, it all ties together. You reveal to us what you're doing in time, and that you are absolutely, totally in control. Sometimes, Lord, we get very impatient, but you're on a different time schedule than we are. Forgive us of our impatience. We know that with you, a day is like 1,000 years, 1,000 years like a day. And Lord, it'll be like that for us in heaven too. We'll just say, oh my, how time flies, or it'll seem like it's not moving at all. Time won't have any constraints on us. We know that we'll be in eternity forever with you. Help us to wrap our heads around the things that we've learned. Just realize how great you are. Dismiss us with your blessing, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Have a great, great night.
You too.
Chapter 7, right?
Chapter 7. I have the cheese. We got
it. We were here 12 hours early. You get here really, really, you get all kinds.